description. Feel free to crosstalk. Feel free to curse, yeah, which you guys obviously know how to do. And
fuck yes.
You're now a day away from opening.
Yep.
Are actually,
you really a few hours?
Open in other places.
Thursday hours, tonight, yeah. Thursday night, 7 p.m. Midnight keeps backing up. You know,
that's true.
Like, it's just so, it's now midweek.
So we witnessed you on your phones checking numbers just a few minutes ago, so I don't want to be coy and pretend you don't care. Yeah. But are you guys like the
we
kind
won't
of
pretend.
People?
We
are you
care.
On top of that always?
Yeah, so I mean, I think it's not that we make any more money if it does well, but I think that Hollywood is a very numbers-driven business, and consequently, our power to get jobs and to have influence moving forward is often linked to how well our movies do. So we do pay pretty close attention to it. I think everyone does. If they tell you they're not, they're probably lying.
Well, there are, I think, 7 people who don't.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, it's like actors who say they don't read the reviews.
Right.
There are a few that I think really
don't
read the reviews.
Right. That's not us.
Some of them can quote them to you.
Yeah.
Whether you know, whether you thought they were reading or not. So when did this particular thing get started for you? Or was Deadpool's first...
2009 is when Ryan first came to us and the studio first came to us. This was after X-Men Wolverine Origins. They wanted to spin Deadpool off into his own franchise. They wanted to do it differently and kind of reboot what had been a misstep in Origins. Mm-hmm. And so we had, interestingly, never read a Deadpool comic. We're comic guys, but it had passed us by in terms of they came out in the 90s. We were not as big comic guys in the 90s as we were in our childhood in the 80s. And so we dove in, you know, head first and read all the comics, read all the runs, and just fell in love with the character. And fell
right away, it was obvious.
Right away, we like, this character speaks to us. It's left of center.
It was about a weekend in between who is this guy and we have to write this movie. Like, it was about 2 days.
Yeah.
And so at that point, it was also, he was going off to do Green Lantern after that?
No, interestingly, he hadn't gotten the Green Lantern job yet. We sat and broke the story with Ryan over the course of the next several months, and then went off to write it and wrote a draft, in 2010. And wrote a subsequent a draft in every year following for the next up until now. So and Ryan had not yet auditioned for Green Lantern. He hadn't done the screen test. He hadn't gotten the job. He was so passionate about Deadpool that he wanted to do Deadpool and really only Deadpool. Until it stalled at Fox for a number of years for a number of reasons, and then he ultimately went off and did Green Lantern. So
when he went to go do that, did you guys just start crying in your
No, we did. We mourned. Yeah. I mean, it was just, it's one of those things where we just couldn't convince the executives, and we said, we're going to lose him to Green Lantern. And it was like a train wreck in slow motion. It just happened right in front of us. And even Ryan said, hey, you're going to lose me to Green Lantern unless you lock me in here. So sign me to some kind of holding deal anyway. Do something.
Give me some indication that you're actually going to make this movie. And
he warned them that he was going to go off and audition for Green Lantern. Yeah. He said, I'm going to get the job. You watch. And lo and behold, he did.
And, you know, it was just one of the many assassins that lurked around the corner over the course of the next 6.5 years from when we first wrote the script.
Mm. So did you keep on, I guess you didn't write on it for that couple years?
Yeah, for a couple years it lay fallow.
No, we wrote drafts in every calendar year.
I guess
so.
No, we must have been, for some reason, rewriting it for somebody.
Because it seemed impossible. Like, it seemed like it was definitely how he could ever do, come back to Deadpool.
Well, interestingly,
getting Green Lantern.
Yeah, like, I mean, for us, it really just, it hit the pause button for us when he went off to do Green Lantern. We thought, well, great, he's going to go off, be a big, you know, become a bigger star. Mm-hmm. The movie's going to do great. And then he's... The passion still remains for Deadpool. So it wasn't one.
So he really wanted to come back.
He did. I mean, Chris Evans had been two different characters at that point, so he figured he probably could too, especially with DC and Marvel being two separate universes. Chris Evans was two within the Marvel universe, unbelievably, both Human Torch and Captain America. But it didn't. We did bring in Tim Miller, got hired in that phase, and he made that test that they gave him about $250,000 to make a short, about 2 minute test of what Deadpool could look like according to his vision. Mm-hmm. And he made the test and it was wonderful, and that still didn't convince them. It was really a bummer. And so we sat on it for another 2 years.
Yeah.
And in the interim time, both David Fincher and James Cameron weighed in on behalf of the movie because they're friends of Tim Miller's and they read the script. And Fox said, okay, they took notice certainly of those two guys thinking it was good. And so they said, okay, well, let's write a PG-13 version. So we wrote a PG-13 version, which sat for a while. And then ultimately it was when, I guess, summer 2014,
yes,
that the original test footage, that little 2 minute segment, leaked onto the internet. And to great fan response, the fans really loved it. And that changed the game a little bit. It got us back on everyone's radar. There was a new regime at Fox. They were really both intrigued and willing to hear more. And Paul convinced Simon Kinberg to come on board. Simon was and is the keeper of the X-Men Universe flame over at Fox, and he had been a fan of the script. And within a few weeks after that, we had a green light. It was really remarkable to watch.
So how was the PG-13 script?
It's not as bad as you'd think, and yet it's not as good as what became the movie. Yeah, I mean, it felt like Diet Coke, you know, versus Coke. It was the pieces were there, but it was just a little anemic.
So if that script had gotten made, you wouldn't have been quite as happy, but
I think we tried our hardest, so I think we still probably would have been happy, though clearly some fans would not have been. I just think the bottom line is it's better with an R. It's just we were able to push so much further in so many different ways. It had been neutered just a little bit. It worked better than we anticipated, though. Like, I think we got
tone
to the end of it.
Tone stayed the same.
Yeah, the tone was pretty similar. We got to the end of it, and we said, okay, we don't hate this. We can live with this. And maybe it was just us trying to rationalize and talk ourselves into it. But it made us feel pretty good at the time. But in retrospect, and Simon looked at both drafts. He looked at both the PG-13 and the R. And we all did, and I think we all just agreed this is the more fun version.
And Fox was ultimately convinced.
Fox, Simon convinced Fox that indeed there's a hole in the marketplace. You know, we can, Fox can do things that Disney can't. You know, Disney can't release an R-rated superhero movie. And so really it was an opportunity to, do something that, in an oversaturated genre of superhero films that people hadn't really seen, at least in the Marvel space, and at least a movie like this that's so hard R and comedic and silly and ridiculous and violent and everything else in between.
Well, I guess the one thing, I mean, the only comparable thing, I guess, is
Kick-Ass?
Kick-Ass in some ways is comparable, but it's a very different, it's not a real superhero movie.
No, I know, you're right.
But last year, Kingsman.
Oh, Kingsman,
kind
yeah.
of in that, is and worked obviously much better than I think anybody anticipated.
Yeah,
we love Kingsman. And I think that at the time we were already rolling, but we thought, aha, it can work. I mean, it's just like this was an R-rated movie that made $400 million.
And interestingly, we're in Kingsman's slot this year.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
A year later, at same studio. Kingsman slot, so they proved that it indeed can work.
So you guys know the geek pressures, people
Very
having
much.
Opinions about everything. I mean, where do you think that is a major influencer in the ultimate success of a movie? Do you think it's something you kind of have to pay fealty to and then, make the movie and sell to everybody else? How do you see it?
We always erred on the side of the nerds, meaning ourselves as well. I mean, we just thought a tie always goes to the nerds, as opposed to the general audience. So we tried our darndest to be faithful to that, and we figured the general audiences would follow. That was the path we chose. That said, I don't know. I mean, there have been some movies that are really caught fire among the smaller Comic-Con community and didn't branch out to the general audience, so I could see a studio certainly, and then of course there are other movies that play too far to the general audience and lose the key core people. So I think you can go wrong in either direction. I think we tried to chart a path that seems to have worked.
Yeah, maybe a little closer to the geeks than
right.
The general audience, but in terms of, I don't think we alienate either side in this film.
So how much, when you guys started, were you unaware of the constraints of studio filmmaking and the questions, what comes from being part of a studio system, and didn't care? Did you grow into it? Did you figure it out as you went?
Well, we were very aware. We've made a couple of studio movies, Zombieland and G.I. Joe, both very different scales and scopes.
But I mean, when you started. I mean, beyond, before even...
Oh, before even
when
that.
You started out in this and you wanted to be screenwriters together.
I think there's a certain naivete that comes. I mean, I was a screenwriter well before Paul was, because we partnered up a little bit later in our respective careers. But I think when you're young, you think you can be Tarantino. You're going to revolutionize Hollywood. Hollywood's going to bend to my will, kind of thing. And it's only over time that you realize, no, that's really not going to happen. Quite the opposite. You're going to have to work your way into the studio system the hard way, and you're going to have to please the people with the deep pockets, and you're going to have to work within genres and not bust genres wide open. So you do learn those constraints, but I do think it's sometimes the moments when you ignore those constraints that are the most productive and that can lead to the most fun project. Zombieland was one that we actually initially wrote for television. We wrote it as a TV pilot and sold it to CBS. And it's amusing in retrospect because we ended up bulking it up to feature length, but we never thought of it as a three-act structure. We never had an inciting incident or a deep gloom moment at the end of Act 2. None of those things. And yet all these...
Or a villain. I mean, other than zombies.
There was no villain.
You know, it's not a traditional...
But a bunch of script analysts online break the movie down. Well, this is where they put the end of Act 1 and Act 2, and this is why they did this. And we say it was nothing like that. We were writing for commercial breaks on CBS. That's how far afield we were from a feature structure. So that, I think that was an example of something that was just, it came from the heart, and we tried to apply that same enthusiasm to the Deadpool story.
So what was it like to have the kind of enthusiasm for that picture before it even came out? I mean, there was this kind of like hum about Zombieland and this kind of passion about it, even before anybody had seen it, really.
And I would say it's the same passion we have for Deadpool, you know?
And the marketing is what inspired it, I think. I mean, we were so lucky in Zombieland to have the tone of the script become the tone of the movie, become the tone of the marketing campaign, and that happened just the same on Deadpool. Somehow the magic of the tone was preserved through those three stages.
Mark Weinstock,
he's the head of marketing, and he did it in each case. And
he did it
brilliant.
At Sony when he was at Sony for Zombieland, and he's doing it now at Fox for us on Deadpool.
So is that your signature now, do you think? If you have an ultimate signature that
Well,
you guys
I don't know. I mean, I hate to think that we have a signature. I mean, in the sense that we've written some serious stuff too, and we have something that we hope to, knock wood, shoot later this summer, which is a thrilling horror thing with not a lot of laughs and very scary. And so it's a sci-fi thriller, really. And so I don't think we really like to get pigeonholed. That said, I do think we have a pretty nice handle on a mixture of action and comedy and romance. I think Zombieland and Deadpool have similar DNA, even though they're very different movies.
Mm. And do you look at something like Deadpool? I mean, what is in the process of doing the script? Are you constantly modulating the level at which you're pushing the envelope, or are you balls to the wall and then pull back when you need to?
We had our foot on the accelerator all the way down pretty much from day one. You know, Ryan, who brought us on, told us, you know, let's write the script we want to write. You know, let's write the script we want to make, and then let's deal with the studio side of it. And we did. And, you know, it was both freeing and kept us from making the movie for 6.5 years, because we finished the draft and we thought, oh my God, this is it. This is brilliant. This is perfect. We're so passionate about this. And then we gave it to the studio and they said, oh my God, we're never making this. Because what have you done? This is not a Marvel superhero movie. This is something very different. And this doesn't fit into the box of superhero studio movies that studios make and spend money on and market. And so it was both a blessing and a curse. But yes, I mean, we were balls to the wall from really the day one get-go, and we really credit Ryan for that. You know, our motto was really to not ask for permission, but to beg for forgiveness. And you know, we make fun of Fox. Like, not only do we break the genre, but we make fun of the studio writing the checks, and you know, ultimately they were game, and that's
a smile on your face.
Yeah, no, it makes me laugh, because it made them laugh. Actually, they were really supportive of those kinds of jokes, and ultimately they found it as funny as we did, which was shocking because it was poking fun at them in particular. But Jim Giannopoulos, his favorite line in the movie is that bit where Deadpool says, it's like you didn't have enough, the studio didn't have enough money for any more X-Men. You know, it's like, that's his favorite line. He laughs harder at that than any of them.
I mean, what drives studios oftentimes, at least of what we've seen, is fear. You know, there's they want to take the safe bet. They want to take the big bet, but they want to take the safe bet, the one that they can point to another movie, you know, that's already happened and had success and say, well, yeah, I did that one because this one was a success. Mm-hmm. And so there can't be any, if that one fails, then they can go, well, you know what, I did it because this one worked. And mm-hmm. So for them to veer off the beaten path and to take this leap with us is a bold decision. Like, it's awesome, and hopefully, you know, we're seeing numbers come in now. It will hopefully pay off for them and us, and it's just great that it confirms the notion that take risks every once in a while. You know, trust the lunatics. Trust, you know, every once in a while we kind of have our finger on the pulse, and it's fun to take those leaps, and it's fun that the studio will hopefully be rewarded at the end of the day for doing so.
Well, the scary comp really is Kick-Ass, because people were so excited about it. Even after they saw it, you know, people were very into that movie, and it did okay, but it certainly did not do the business that, you know, the dream was.
Right. It did enough to justify a sequel, but I think it only made, what, $125 million?
Well, the sequel, I think, also underperformed.
Yeah, that did underperform.
You know, but people were expecting that to, you know, okay, this is how it works now. Right. You're going to go from that. The DVD is going to be big. And then
Watchmen didn't do as well. Yeah, I mean, but interesting.
Hellboy had the same, you know, unfortunate but popular, you know, beloved by the people who saw it. But then just there were a lot of people just didn't want to see it.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, what I would say is, you know, Deadpool is, I think, a much better known character than anyone, you know, any kid.
Who knows Deadpool? I mean, that's like, I'm fascinated by that.
No, but really, because
when I heard your tracking numbers, I got to say, my hair kind of like on the back of my neck went like, how can they be tracking that big?
Right.
Yeah. Domestically, it's kind of breathtaking, because
I think Deadpool, if you guys didn't know Deadpool
when you started, you know.
Yeah.
I think probably what they tapped into is the same thing that made those first 50,000 hardcore people love Deadpool is making all these new people love Deadpool. It's the character, just because it hadn't expanded didn't mean it didn't have the potential to expand, because he's those qualities of his, the irreverence and the pushing boundaries and the won't shut up and the tough guy action hero and all those things combined in one, and the cool suit, that they're entertaining. I mean, there's a reason why there was a pretty good cult following for
him. I would say it wasn't entirely a cult following. Like, he was a mainstream Marvel character. I mean,
he's probably their best-selling character after Spider-Man, you know, coming into the...
Yeah. See, that's how old I am, I guess.
But comics are, they're smaller scale in terms of the overall base than movies are, so you're not going to get that many, you know, 45-year-old women reading comics. There's some, but whereas you're going to get a fair amount of 45-year-old women going to this movie, we hope, anyway. That's the hope.
Well, I guess the other comp for you guys is Guardians.
Guardians, which, is a good,
you know,
comp.
Was Kingsman, much, though, even is more also, of right. a, you know, unknown brand.
Right.
But that, whatever that marketing was, those ads and that trailer
worked,
and people were anxious to go.
And it was a good movie.
Yeah.
It's funny, that old George Santayana quote about, if you don't learn from the past, you're condemned to repeat it. I think it's a little dangerous, because learning from the past, I mean, nothing from the past correlates exactly with the present. There are different details in play. Like, just because Watchmen only did this number doesn't mean Deadpool isn't going to do that number. I mean, we in Hollywood try to make sense of the noise. We try to make sense of all of this random noise. And oftentimes we draw conclusions that are just false. Like a whole genre, oh, that's dead. Nobody likes that anymore.
Or, you can't do, you know, horror comedy. Horror comedy doesn't work. Well, it worked. It worked with Zombieland.
So, a great example. Or, you know, it feels like we draw so many conclusions based on the past that just don't necessarily apply to the present, and there are always surprises.
Nobody knows anything, right?
Yeah, I mean, The Blind Side. Who saw that coming? I mean, it's like and we were literally blindsided by The Blind Side. You know? I mean, exactly. So, I don't know. Like, I as a studio executive, I think would be very careful not to draw too many conclusions from past performance for fear of just missing creating the next new thing by virtue of trying to follow what's come before.
Yeah.
No, it's an impossible task, and also delayed by number of years.
Exactly.
Which so also makes it harder. But I mean, I do think that the marketing, ultimately, if they see what it is as represented in that marketing and they love that, they're going to go no matter whether it's the most known thing, and they're not going to go if it's a known thing and they don't like it. You know, with a few exceptions. Sometimes they show up anyway.
Yes. Right.
But mostly, it's kind of a fascinating.
Yeah, and I do think also quality probably plays a little more into the equation than it used to, because people share opinions so much quicker on social media. you can have a movie come out on a Thursday night and word starts to spread that it's no good, and it really affects that weekend. In the old days, you wouldn't really be able to share the story of whether you liked a movie or didn't like the movie till you showed up at high school the next week and talked to your friends face to face. It was just different. Now, the instantaneousness of social media allows opinions to influence other opinions on a Friday night. And
on
that's
a Thursday night.
A Thursday night. So and even now, like internationally, the opinion, you know, it's been out for a couple of days. I think those opinions hopefully will affect Americans. So there is something really to be said for quality, I think. There are those bad movies that steamroll an audience, you know, but I think this...
Well, there's something they like in those movies.
Yeah, true. And that's the other thing, is yeah. oftentimes there
things
is.
Things we it's may not hate like you get, or somebody yeah, else really likes.
Exactly. You know? And so it's not necessarily they're getting faked out, but a bad movie has fewer places to hide anymore, and I think a good movie spreads more quickly.
See, I still don't buy the speed of... Well, the instantaneous thing. I think opening weekend still... People made a decision the week
either
before.
Either they're going or they're not
going. They're
going
to the movies or they're not. And if they hear it's bad, they want to find out. And if they hear it's good, they want to...
Yeah, I mean, you may be right.
And then the second weekend heavily influenced.
I wonder whether at some level you're just trying to convince a human being to do something, and psychologically somewhere in their makeup is they're going to make a decision, is this is the kind of movie I want to see or it's not the kind of movie I want to see.
Yeah.
And you can make them aware of it and you can push it and you can sell it in 18 different ways, but ultimately they're either going to go
or
they're not.
The word of mouth does matter.
I don't think it does in the first weekend. I think you see Saturday numbers that really show
reflect
the feeling about the Fridays.
The marketing guys would disagree with you because I just talked to them about it, but you may be right, or they may be right. It's tough.
Well,
I'm
a numbers guy for many years, so I keep on, you know, everybody keeps on wanting that to make sense, but I mean, sometimes coincidentally it does. But Saturday changes are still obvious.
I would love for it to be a myth or an old wives' tale, because I love stories like that.
But you guys came in, I mean, ultimately, as I say, you guys came on tracking very hot.
Right.
So you may be 10% over, you may be 20% over, or maybe, you know, whatever.
Right.
But I think that's... That's a function of enthusiasm also,
enthusiasm,
and people taking their friends, and
actual opinions.
Whether it's a Saturday night date movie or not, you know, how plays a girl, all that stuff becomes, I think, is more significant until... enough people have seen it that the next weekend they're, you know, have to see it.
Right.
Or not. Which a not is much more popular than it used to be. Anyway, enough about numbers. So was there anything you guys wrote that you went, well, we can't do that. That's too much.
I would say no. We really were careful not to self-censor as we were writing, because we just wanted to push it. And then the studio was so terrific about letting us do whatever we wanted that really the answer is no. There isn't some rougher, harder director's cut waiting for
well, no,
masses.
I just mean that you guys sitting in the room were going, oh, God.
This was a character we never self-centered. We always pushed
I think there were some times when we collectively said, oh, maybe that's a little too mean, that joke or something. But it was very rare. It was never that, oh, my gosh, we're going to offend people, or, oh, that really upsets decorum. We were not...
He's politically incorrect character. He's offensive to everyone and everything, and so... You know, that's freeing as a screenwriter to be able to just go nuts.
Was there a joke you thought they wouldn't let you have?
All of them.
Yeah, in a way they didn't let us have all of them for a long time, but then all of a sudden they did and the floodgates opened and they allowed everything.
Once they were going for it, they were going for it as much as you were. Mm. And what's your favorite joke in the movie?
I think I may be mutually. There's a moment at the end where Vanessa says to Wade, "It's a face I'd be happy to sit on," and by virtue of its placement in the movie and the fact that it's the romantic moment and the fact that no one expects that line to come out of her mouth, I think we both love
it.
It's
my favorite line of the movie. Rhett wrote it, and when I read it, I loved it. I thought, oh my God, and then I thought I hated it because I thought, oh my God, the studio's never ever making this movie. Like, you can't have
the whole movie's going down.
You know, this isn't Sleepless in Seattle anymore.
Yeah.
It's like, it's a face I'd be happy to sit on. Holy shit. Like, Fox, 20th Century Fox, Rupert Murdoch. Like,
the line that seems to get the biggest reaction, having watched it with multiple studios, is it was a Ryan ad lib, which was
multiple
the one,
audiences.
Yeah, sorry. That's what I meant. Multiple audiences. Is that line where he leaves the X-Mansion and he turns back to Negasonic and says, it's funny, I only ever see two of you here. It's like the studio didn't have enough money. That particular line, it seems to get audiences the best. And that was a Ryan ad lib on the day. He just made that up. He was thinking of different things to say as he walked away, and he just threw that out there, and we went crazy. I mean, and then the audiences went crazy.
Yeah, and Jim Giannopoulos' favorite joke, too, because it's true. We could only afford two X-Men.
But they were really good X-Men.
They were fun.
They couldn't afford Cyclops until the last movie, really. So you got him before anybody else did.
Yeah.
In some ways. I had a question in my head that completely just disappeared.
Okay.
It's brilliant. I don't know how that happens. Wow. I'm completely brain dead. My brain just stopped working.
What I might want to
What would you like to say? How do you feel about it? What about hooker stripper? Have you heard that complaint from people?
What, the fact that she, well, she's not a stripper. She's become a cocktail waitress at the end. So in other words, she didn't, at some point in there, she made the decision to give up the life.
It's the only mincing complaint that I've heard.
I don't know if
mincing is the right word. Or even a word I'm allowed to use out loud.
So we can defend ourselves?
Just that somehow she was downgraded from hooker to, you know, cocktail waitress at a strip club.
That's somehow you gave up on her
prostitution.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Oh, you mean that she should have just stuck to her. Our idea was always, and I don't know if it comes across in the script. We had an earlier draft where she says, "I quit my day job." Was that just as they got into a relationship together, she stopped being a prostitute because she was in love with this guy, and I don't think that necessarily comes across. I think it's implied, it's like she's clearly, if she's accepting a marriage proposal, you know, she's not going to be sleeping with every guy every night.
I was willing to take the leap, but I'm just saying it's like there's so few people complaining about this movie in any way. That's like one of the few things I've heard anybody kind of
we don't hear too many. I mean, that we get the juvenile complaint, but I figure calling Deadpool juvenile is like saying you don't like that. It's like saying I don't like the Hulk because he's strong. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like that's his defining characteristic. Yeah. Like that's what. So we were writing to that. Like he is very much like that in the comics. And if you don't like that style of humor, then you don't like that style of humor. But that's what we've shot for.
And, you know, the movie is a love story. It's many things. It's a love story. It's the beating heart of the movie. It's the fact that these two broken souls find each other and fall in love really grounds the characters, makes you care about them, so that when Deadpool is silly and ridiculous, there is the empathy and the feeling of, my God, you know, he had found this girl, he had fallen in love with her, then he lost her, he made the decision and he lost her, and now he's trying to get her back. Like, that really does ground the movie in a way that makes it feel that you can laugh with these characters and you can cry with these characters and you can feel with these characters because the love story feels so real. I think that's one thing people are saying about the Vanessa character, mm-hmm. is that she does give as well as she gets. And she's a strong female character, and really that relationship is so very important to really making the movie click together as one whole piece that works and feels consistent.
Well, I think I tweeted something out about it being a surprisingly feminist movie, given that the lead female starts as a prostitute. But also I thought that the X-Men girl, I don't know the right name for that.
Yeah.
It seems much more like a normal girl in this than you usually see in comic book movies.
Yeah, I mean, we just felt like that. There's that certain stage in a lot of teenage girls' lives where they just suddenly nothing becomes cool for wherever they are. They want to be somewhere else. Like,
right.
And we thought, wouldn't it be funny if here's a girl who's in the X mansion, this amazing place. She's out watching this guy shoot a bunch of people. She's fighting bad guys, and yet she still would prefer to be. So she's still tweeting something or texting to her friends. Like that just felt very real to us.
Which also not built like a Barbie. She's
built like
a normal teenage girl. Yeah.
And she beats ass. Like when it comes time to beat ass, she throws down her phone and starts beating ass. Like she's pretty fun. We like that character. I mean, some people have talked about. What if, you know, there's actually a Negasonic Teenage Warhead comic now? Because so far she's just been a tiny little ancillary character in this larger universe. I think she was in one issue.
And we put her in simply those three words, her name, Negasonic Teenage Warhead. We're like,
I don't even
give a shit what her powers are. Like
that's
I don't care. Like, that's the name. Like, that's it. She's cast. Like, we're done. Because
it implies so much. Like, and including implying a power that she never even originally had. We turned her into almost a physical warhead because we thought that was such a fun name.
That was one of the few things we actually needed to get Marvel's approval on when we changed her powers. Because her powers were
psychic abilities.
And we wanted her to see herself blow up.
Much more interesting.
Much more interesting.
Well, with a name like Negasonic Teenage Warhead.
Yeah.
For sure.
You have to get a little picture on your wall with Negasonic Teenage Warhead.
Yeah.
And did you guys, and was there much, when you talked about Ryan doing an ad lib and whatever, I mean, did you guys do much in ADR or rewrite lines as
you got closer?
Very much. We worked harder from final wrap to lock than we've ever worked, before, like in terms of just, because he is in a mask, because you can't put words in his mouth. It was very much, you know, writing and rewriting, you know, from right up until, you know, the final few days of locking picture.
Yeah.
Which is a blessing and a curse. Yeah. As screenwriters, it feels great because you can alter a scene or you know, alter motivation or a journey. And the curse being that exact same thing is that you can alter a journey or a course or a character right up until.
So it wasn't just punchlines that you changed.
It was exhausting. Was some logic stuff too. Yeah, I mean, mostly it was for laughs, and mostly it was for character. There are a few logical things we dropped in here and there, mostly about Wade's transformation into Deadpool, because the science of it wouldn't quite pass Neil deGrasse Tyson standards, and it was a little confusing, and so we had to do a fair amount of work with Ed Skrine to just streamline it and make everybody understand, at least in some basic fashion, this is how the serum went into him, this is why he needs to be tortured, and this is how he became Deadpool. It does not pass muster, probably, but at least comic book logic works.
So is this as happy as you've been going into an opening day?
Yeah. I mean, Zombieland was newer. It was sort of more virgin territory
but
for us.
But nothing like this. This has been a rocket ride, just in terms of like...
Just amazing.
Because again, it has been such a struggle. These 6.5 years have been, I'd say, at times painful, to the point where we thought if we don't get this movie made, we may never write another movie, just because if we can't get this particular project going. It's a Marvel superhero movie. It's our favorite script we've ever written.
What does that say about all of our other projects?
So to actually, have it, we always said to each other as we were going through the ups and downs of this process, and way more downs than ups, is we said, If we're so lucky to get this thing made, this better have a fucking happy ending.
Right? We also asked each other many times, all of our projects, if you could have one of them go, like if you could just wave your magic wand and make one of them happen, what would it be? And it was always Deadpool. Like
most filmmakers, it's this small indie movie, that the script is sitting in your drawer and it's bizarre and
your childhood or something.
And Deadpool, the Marvel superhero comic book movie was ours. We had such a passion for it. So to see it, what will hopefully be, a happy ending is just absolutely, thrilling for us. And because we poured so much heart and soul and blood, sweat,
and you
tears.
Can pour just as much heart and soul into something that doesn't have a happy ending. So, and we have seen that happen many times to many folks. And
no doubt will happen to you again.
Yeah, no, and it's all over. Will happen to
Don't
us again.
Say that.
It's happened to us before, but hopefully not on this one. Let's knock wood. We'll see.
No,
but
this one you seem to be pretty safe.
Yeah,
on Thursday afternoon.
Yeah, yeah. Safe as you can be on the eve of opening weekend, which is terrifying. But
yeah, but I mean, this is it seems like the ultimate teenage rebellion for screenwriters.
Maybe
you're actually doing this. This is when you say a quirky little indie film. In some ways, you got a chance to do that at a studio level.
Lunatics ran the asylum for this one, yeah.
And, Ryan and us have been just attached to the hip from the very beginning on this thing. So we're texting back and forth, almost on a near minute-by-minute basis as numbers come in internationally. And the only thing we're bemoaning is the fact that we're not all sitting in a room together watching it happen. So he's in New York.
You guys could end up in the Canadian Hall of Fame.
I'm Canadian.
He is Canadian.
You're actually Canadian.
Yeah, well, yes, so and he and go. Ryan both. But I am striking a blow for America because Thursday night, tonight, we're going to make ourselves heard. By God.
Thank you guys very much.
Thank you so much.
That was fun.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Great questions.
Thanks.
Great question.
Except when I completely forgot I was speaking English.
Oh, that's okay. It happened.